grab your Bibles at least one more time, and if you are able to open them to the book of Matthew chapter 2. And if you can stand with me as we read together Matthew chapter 2, I will do my best to close out this presentation by 12, so at least you have some idea. And unless I have a call for more, then we'll push more. But that'll be up to you this morning. Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Very familiar Christmas passage. The old adage, familiarity can breed little interest. I pray that even though you may have heard this or read this, that something fresh will come from it. Tell me if you have the passage. Now when Jesus was born, where, beloved? In Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, and they were saying, where is he that is born? Notice, king. Say that word with me. King. One more time. King of the Jews, for we have seen his star in the east, and we've come to worship him. And Herod the king had heard these things. Notice his reaction. King James says he was troubled. Greek is he was angry and concerned. Notice, beloved, verse 3, and all of Jerusalem was troubled with him. Not just him, but all within Jerusalem with this saying. When he had gathered all of the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them, where is this Christ to be born? And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written by the prophet. Micah chapter 5 verse 2, just for your information. And out of Bethlehem in the land of Judah shall come the least of princes of Judah, for out of you shall come a governor, a ruler, a prince, a king, and he shall rule my people Israel. Verse 7, and Herod, when he had called the wise men privately, inquired of them and said, what time did the star appear? And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. And when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east, what did it do? Verse 9, what did it do? Come on with me, what did it do? Went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced and were exceedingly happy. Verse 11, and when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother. Notice their reactions, beloved. What did they do first? They kneeled down or fell down and worshiped him. When they had opened, King James says, their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream, they should not return to Herod. They departed into their own country another way. Verse 16. Then Herod, whom saw he was mocked by the wise men, was exceedingly filled with rage. Sent forth, and notice, beloved, he slew all of the children that were in Bethlehem, and all of the coasts that were from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. Verse 23. And he came and dwelt in a city, Joseph and Mary, called Nazareth. It might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets. He shall be called a Nazarene. Jesus, thank you again for your beautiful church this morning and those that are meeting underneath your precious name. I would pray that even though it is a familiar passage in your holy word, that you would use something spiritual and divine to give us life today. We look to you to do this, and we don't look to anyone else. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. title of this presentation is called Searching for the Perfect Gift. Searching for the perfect gift. It was the week before Christmas and parking spaces were hard to come by. Or should I say it's 2 weeks. Long lines, crowded stores, and rude people. But lots of sales. In one long checkout line, one man was heard to say, "They should kill the guy who started Christmas." One wise and godly woman in the back of the line shouted, "They did. They hung him on a cross." Therein lies the real Christmas story. Some people are hard to shop for. You have no idea what to get them, what size or color. Some are just plain picky. But did you know, beloved, that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, to whom there is no variableness, no shadow of turning, no changing. Did you know when he was thinking about you and endeavoring what would be the perfect gift to give you? He gave you the person Jesus Christ. Put your hands together and thank him for him, won't you? During this Christmas season, I want to remind you and I of the good and perfect gifts God has given you. He's given you again Jesus Christ. Call him Jesus. He'll save you and I from our sins. But I want you to notice, beloved, in terms of, I guess, points, if some of you will take notes, is number one, that he gave Christ initially to us as an infant. He gave him to you and I as a small baby. Didn't give him to you and I initially as a full-grown man, but he gave him to you and I as a small infant. This Christmas, I want it to be a reminder, number one, despise not small beginnings in your life. Despise not the small beginnings in your life. This infant, Jesus Christ, as small as he was, grew to become the greatest and the most explosive movement on the face of the earth that continues even now over 2,000 years. Wherever you are and whatever is taking place in you, I want to remind you the power of small things. I want to underscore the power of small things within your life. I want your Christmas to be a reminder that Jesus Christ, even though it began small, it is a movement that has touched every nation upon the earth that you live in. Maybe you're looking at your situation and you've had to start over. And maybe you've lost a job with an oil company, or maybe a relational situation has happened. And you're looking at your situation and it seems so infantile, so small. I'm here to again tell you, do not despise, Zechariah says, chapter 4, the power of small beginnings in your life. It is a small beginning, but God, if you're faithful, can bring great things out of your life. Unto us a child is born, and a son is given. Children are born, sons must be given. And the government, the authority will rest on his shoulders. We've taught this, that's you. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, and the increase of his government, there'll be no end. The zeal of the Lord will perform this. I want to speak to you a minute about the power of small things. I want you to understand the need for process. that if he were to give it to you all in a one quick swoop and sweep, you wouldn't be able to survive. If you had a heart to start a Christian school, you can talk to Mrs. Thurman over there for 37 years. She would tell you that that school, if it was given to you at that size and capacity, it would kill you. That you need to value the process of being small and allowing God to grow this and to develop your character so that you have an immunity to withstand the very pressures that are going to come when it's big. Did you hear me? It's important that you see that in the process, he is going to grow an immunity in your life to be able to manage what is going to come when that little baby begins to grow in your life. Someone shout the small things. Starting small grows your character. You can handle criticisms. I said you can handle criticisms. You can handle challenges. You can handle gossip. Oh, really quiet on that one. You can handle gossip. And still not have your spirit disrupted. You can still go to sleep. You can still drink your coffee. Proverbs 20:21, an inheritance given quickly at the beginning will not be blessed at the end. I'm going to pause and thank God for my early afflictions, because it has helped me with my current afflictions. Ah, you're not here today. I'm going to talk to you over here. I'm going to thank him for my early afflictions, because it's helped me with my current afflictions. That everything that has happened in your life, again, has the DNA to prepare you for what God has coming for your life. You need to recognize and to embrace the process that God is taking you through right now and right here, and begin to have a divine power shift of what God is doing in your life. Someone here has to start over. And you're wondering, at my age, what am I going to do? I'm here to tell you, because you've been faithful, God will accelerate the process in your life. You've had to change jobs. You had to move. This happened. She left you. He left you. I'm here to tell you, start right now. God will get behind you, because he can trust your life. You serve a God who didn't start big. He started small. He didn't create the entire world you live in one day. He's not afraid to start small. Don't you be afraid to start small. Start with the small dream, the small vision, the small part, the small business, the small ministry, the small idea. Don't be afraid. God wasn't afraid to start small. Despise not small beginnings. When he wanted to call a nation, he called one man, Abraham. When a woman was dying of starvation, he said, take one pot of oil. When he needed to feed 5,000, he called a little boy's lunch bag and said, pull out two fish and them five loaves and spread it around. Someone shout, start small. If you get there too soon and too quick, you'll have the fruit, but no root. Now you ought to tweet that somewhere. Who's listening to me today? If you get there too quickly, you'll have the fruit and what? And no root. We want drive-by blessings. I said, we want drive-by blessings. We want give it to me yesterday, God. And he says, no, I'm interested in process, because you're going to live forever with me, and I'm more concerned about your character than your comfort. I'm more concerned about your holiness than your happiness. Aaron's rod brought forth buds, and it budded, and it brought forth blossoms, and then it brought forth fruit. Despise not small beginnings. I'm here to tell someone, don't despise the small things that are happening in your life, in your marriage, in your spiritual movements. He's the Alpha and what? Amen. He's the Alpha and what? Amen. And he's the Omega. Number two. The Bible says that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Bethlehem has a double meaning. It means house of bread. He's the bread of life, right? I said he's the bread of life. He's the bread of his people. I want you to be reminded that there's going to be nothing that's going to be given to you or that you're ever going to get that's ever going to satisfy the bread of life, Jesus Christ. I'm glad when you get a new car, I'll rejoice with you. But after a while, that French fry is going to go right down in that little spot. You swore you'd never eat in it. You made no one ever, you made them take your shoes off. But the fry slipped right down in there. And then after the fry came that hard shell Taco Bell taco. And that lettuce flipped right in there too. And you tried to get it and you were so upset and praying for it. And then after a while, it's okay to eat in the car. Now it smells like a French fry in a taco. Beloved, this Christmas, be reminded that nothing, as great as it is only temporary in this life. Yep, I want the Bentley 2008 with a rag top, but it ain't going to fill it. I said it's not going to fill it up. There's going to be a scratch in your heart. Beloved, right now he has made everything in this world and everyone in this world the need to have him. Bill Gates, I promise you, according to this word, goes to bed scratching his heart because there's an empty place that belongs to Jesus Christ. And you should put your hands together because Christ is your bread of life. You can go to bed with a peace in your heart that he has chosen you. I said he's chosen you. He chose you. I said he picked you, hand-picked you. That should break off a rejected spirit. It also means the house of war. Now listen to me, you're going to have family. And you're going to have to deal with some things. Because now your Christianity is on trial. You have to realize this, that when Christ comes into your life, it might make people be at war with you. You prepared for that Christian? I said, are you prepared for that Christian? Jesus himself said in Matthew 10:34, think not I've come to send peace on the earth. I've come to bring a sword of division. Father against son, mother against daughter, mother-in-law. This is scripture for some of you. Mother-in-law against mother-in-law. You'll get that on the way home. But be reminded that Christ in you can stir up conflict. I said it can stir up conflict. And you and I cannot retreat. I said you can't retreat. Your job isn't somehow to bring this false sense of unity. You are a Christian. I said, you are a Christian. Amen. Number three, be reminded of the leaven of Herod. This Christmas, one, realize that God is going to use you in the small things in your life. Realize, number two, that Bethlehem is a place of bread and a place of war. Realize, number three, the leaven of Herod. Matthew 2:2, Herod said, where is he born king of the Jews? Now we won't take too much time, but if you were to see the lineage of Herod's their lineage was genetic evil. If you were to follow them all the way in their genetic line, every Herod and their lineage was genetic evil. bloodshed, murders, killings. You would dial it all the way back to Esau. Herods in your Bible are related to Esau. Esau, you remember, was appetite driven. I called it the pottage syndrome. He sold the birthright for a bowl of pottage. That Herod and the Herodian syndrome is consumed by now. Give it to me today, and I'll be nice to you if you can help me in that spot. The Herods were deplorable. And they wanted, and he wanted to know, where is this Jesus, King of the Jews? The leaven of Herod that Jesus spoke about in, where did he speak about that? Mark 8:15. The leaven of Herod, listen to this. He doesn't want to relinquish his throne, his rulership to Jesus Christ. Beware of the leaven of Herod. When you as a Christian bring Christ with you, it automatically, spiritually, begins to bring forth a caustic, possibly, reaction in some people. Why? Because now you're bringing a kingly anointing with you. Now it begins to challenge who is king in that life. The leaven of Herod does not want to forfeit its throne. The strongest repelling dynamic of the presentation of Christ, we have said, isn't the belief of miracles, power gifts, signs and wonders. It is the presentation of Christ as king over one's life. Listen, beloved. As you and I leave this campus and you go your way, realize that the essential issue within humanity is going to be the leaven of Herod. Who is going to rule the throne of one's life? Herod said, a king is coming. We must kill him. I won't allow another to reign and to rule and to have a throne other than me. That is the leaven of Herod, and it is a spiritual dynamic that invades the lives of every single one, saved, yea, and unsaved. People praising God and worshiping God and speaking in tongues and moving in gifts of the Spirit. But the essential question is, who is on the throne of that life? Is it Jesus Christ or is it Herod? It is the leaven of Herod where one, there is a resistance to allow Christ to have the throne of one's heart. And so he began to kill children 2 years and under. A hostility towards Christian and Christianity. All over the world, media, politicians. Why? Because there is a presentation of lordship. Why are you allowed to say Happy Hanukkah, but you can't say Merry Christmas? Why? Because Christ is in that name. Why can you say Happy Kwanzaa, but you can't say Merry Christmas? There's no presentation of authority and the throne in those areas. Why now are we reduced down to happy holidays? Beloved, if they tell you happy holidays, you have it here from me in a handwritten memo. You turn and say, Merry Christmas to you. If you believe that, put your hands together. The leaven of Herod does not want to acknowledge the lordship and the kingly mantle of Christ on your life and heart. He'll allow you to have trees, bells and silver ribbons, presents. But he came, who's still listening? He came to be king. I said he came to be king. And he will return. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Like it or not, he'll take his rightful place on every nation, on every life, in the name of Jesus Christ. Beloved, where were the religious leaders? The news was spread abroad. From Malachi, the closing book of the Old Testament, 400 years of dark silence. The scribes, the Pharisees, knew that there have been hundreds of prophecies about a Messiah to come. They were waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, asking, "Are you the Messiah? Are you the Messiah to come? Are you the Messiah to come?" They knew the Torah. They knew the books of the Bible. They had memorized them. They knew the Messiah was coming. They knew the timetables. They knew the seasons. And yet when they heard from the wise men through the movement of a supernatural star that the Messiah had been born, the Bible says that it spread all through Jerusalem. Where were they? Why didn't they come to worship him? Where did the scribes go? Where were the Pharisees? Religion has a difficult time bowing down. Oh, we'll stop right now then, won't we? Yeah. God bless you. Religion has a tough time kneeling. Preacher, that's over the limit. I go to church. This is getting to be too much. Now we're gonna kneel? Well, where did the religious people go? Religion rather than relationship. Performance rather than the person. Is that how you evaluate this? Is it like, well, I had a good day and a bad day? This is a relationship. Rules rather than radical love. Where were the religious people? Bible says the wise men fell down, kneeled, and he was a baby. They just saw him for a few minutes. Some of you have seen newborn babies, and imagine coming in and all of a sudden you just fall down and began to weep and to worship. That Pharisee said, "Hey, that's too much. Preacher, don't ask me to raise my hands. Hey, I'm here. Don't ask me to lift up hands. I don't want to. I don't feel like it." Well, who asked you how you felt? Who asked you whether you wanted to or didn't want to? All through your Bible, it's something he wants. Something he wants. Something he's asked for. Who is on your throne? You glad you came?
Yes.
Oh, this is going to look stupid. With praying in tongues. He'll use the foolishness of this world to confound the wise. He'll use little gibberish.
His baby talk.
Yeah, just let faith pick that little thing up. Picked mine right up. All I had was Uduka, Uduka. That's me, Uduka. Your voice, get in faith and believe I'm going to use that. Now I got a little river flowing. Well, that's for you. That's for all of us. Don't got everybody on board today. How about you watching? I want you on board. were the religious people. Beloved, is there a spirit of religion where somehow there are these restrictions that you can't kneel down and rend your heart and say, I am so thankful and grateful that you have saved me, that I can worship you, and I don't care who laughs at me. Better to have the approval of God than look for the approval of you. Because when you see him face to face, you're not going to find him and her and that one and this one. It's just going to be you. And if you have trouble here and now, believe me, you won't have trouble then. You might as well get ready. The Father seeks those that will worship him, spirit and in soul. Hey, where was the population? Everybody in Jerusalem heard. Huh, the wise men were there. Man, they might have come all the way from India, China. Doesn't tell us. Doesn't even tell us how many. Where was everybody at? This is a Messiah. I mean, you got 400 prophecies. Hey, he's coming about right now. And everybody, even the king, it was proclaimed all over Jerusalem. Where was everybody? Wow. Nobody showed up. Hey, probably the playoffs were on. I said the playoffs were on. Room for houses, lands, and pleasures. Room for things that pass away. But for the one that lives forever, just no room today. Suppose they were too busy. I suppose the priorities weren't in line. I suppose this one who we proclaim really didn't mean that much at all. Now get off of that. It kind of hurts a little bit, doesn't it? They saw the star in the east. It went before them, brought them to where Christ was. I'm thankful and joyful for the star that has led me to Christ. Hey, you know you got a good church? Yeah. That might work, that one. You know you got a good church? Yeah. That's a little better. You know you got a good church? Yeah. I said, do you know you got a good church? Yeah. Do you know you got good worship here? Yeah. Do you know you got good preaching here? Yeah. Do you know you got good church members here? Yeah. Ah, I said, do you know that? Yeah. But it's only a star. The wise men didn't worship the star. The wise men worshiped Christ. I'll send out a second memo. This is a good church, but it isn't going to answer for all of your problems and mine. I'm going to make sure that's sunk in. The star is to get you to him. But it isn't going to fix me. It'll do its best, but Jesus Christ and him alone is your answer. Put your hands together so I feel like the star was never to be the object of their worship. Christ was. It won't take time, but I was going to move in a little bit on this star and the difference between astrology and astronomy. Oh, look at there, they're following the star around. Matter of fact, if you had time, we'd go through the constellations that Job talks about. Six of them. Amos talks about another two of them. I think they have tried to surmise in terms of the astronomers that there are 13 viable constellations. Your Bible speaks of almost every single one of them. Did you know that? Did you know the enemy perverts what God has already created? Did you know he's a counterfeiter? And he'll take the aspects of stars to whom God has named and has numbered? Side note, this one's free. But if you were to take time and go through the actual Hebrew word of Nazarene, the Bible says he was a Nazarene. Nowhere in the Old Testament does it speak of Christ being a Nazarene. You begin to follow the actual roots of Nazarene and you're going to come up with the word, are you ready? Are you ready? Yes. The actual word called Zodiac. Maseroth. It means Zodiac. Now, before you run out of here, wondering where I'm going with it, trying to ground you, Christian. So just because you get a prefix, like in Waco, Texas, 25 years ago, of 666, you don't lose control that God is on the throne. That's going to tip you over. Zodiac, Maseroth. Job 38, verses 31 through 33. It's talking about constellations. It literally meant zodiac. Zodiac means the way and the path. That the stars that God has put in holy constellations actually speak of him. Actually speak of Jesus Christ. Not sorcery, not astrology, but divine astronomy. When they were following a star, there was a divine alignment that the wise men and the magi understood why, because they were divine astronomers. They weren't afraid of zodiac. They weren't afraid of astrology. They knew that God had placed them, the book of Job, in a host of places in the heavenlies. He has ordered them and he has numbered them. And one of them brought them right to Jesus Christ. I'll finish here. Right on time, good preacher. They fell down and they worshiped him. This Christmas, I want it to be a reminder that true worship again is where you and I, and most of you, understand this, where your heart truly has been touched by Christ and you're so thankful in your heart. They opened their treasures. Let's stop. What's your treasure? What's most meaningful to you? I want to suggest number one is your time. Who's listening? Hey, who's listening? You cannot get time back. I can buy a new house. I can buy a new car. I can buy that back, but time should be a treasure. It's like a toilet roll. The older you get, the faster that thing spins at the end. Going to be 59 years old. I don't look a day over 70, do I? 59. Wow. I remember when I was 20 sitting there and one of the stars that God had put in my life showing me what it means to sell out. Telling me what the deeper life really means. It's beyond church, Steve. It's beyond rules and regulations. It is a personal relationship where there comes an inner witness. That even if I don't know why and how come and I don't have the answers, there's an inner witness that I know he's sovereign. And I can't tell you why Pastor Dusty Kemp passed away last week.
can't tell you why I hate alarms. Hush. Thank you. I'll stop like I said. You don't want me to stop, do you? Well, the new people might be going, Two-minute extended play, or are you done? I got this memo from Charisma Magazine and said this. If you're preaching longer, preacher, than 30 minutes, let me tell you, you are a mess. And I thought to myself, the average sermon in America, ready? Are you ready? 17 minutes. The average total service in America, average, 46 minutes from start to finish. And you got the hordes of hell beating against your people, coming against your people, and 48 minutes from start to finish is going to drive out the enemy in their life. You're going to get it all done in that amount of time, once a week, maybe. Something has to change. I said something has to change. I don't know why he passed away. Listen to me, beloved. The enemy looks for certain places of attack. Please listen. One of them comes because of poor theology in that Christian. It is called a theological weakness in that Christian. Situations happen with them, and because they have poor theology, they cannot begin to assimilate and understand what to do and how to do it. And now here comes a spirit that begins to call them to question, hath God said, how come he has done this? How come this happened to him? Why did he die? And how come he lived? It is called a weakness of theology within that saint, that they can't manage the plethora of things that are going on within their life. And so consequently, the enemy takes advantage of them. And now I got to sit them down and say, what is going on in your head? Is there not an inner witness that maybe you can't understand it yet? And do you need to understand before you go on? Then you will become God. He doesn't have to tell me anything. I said, he doesn't have to tell me anything. He saved me. I am his. I have been bought with a price. What would you like me to do? I am yours. You are mine. I am here to serve you. Hey, over in Mexico, last conference we just did. Called up. There's deaf people in this congregation, 1,500 people. Deaf left ear, 7 people stood up. Called them up, commanded the spirit, the deaf spirit, broken out of their lives. 5 of the 7 healed. 5 of 7. Now, if there is theological weakness, 2 of them are going to walk away going, God doesn't love me. 2 of them are going to walk away and the enemy is going to pound them unless they are theologically strong and have an understanding of what this book says. It's not enough to have 1 scripture here and 1 scripture here. That's why you come to this church. Because Paul says, it's the sum of thy word that is truth. Not just this and this, it's all of this. If you don't know all of this, you are going to get whipped like a whipsaw. You remember the house that fell? 2 houses, 2 Christian houses. 1 was built on the rock. Who's that? Built on him. built on his word. The other one was built on what? Sand is granules of the rock. Didn't have all of it, but just had particles of it. What happened to that house? It collapsed. One of the reasons why we encourage you to eat God's word is because it will flush out theological weaknesses and give you a foundation to stand and have done all. I am still here. I am still here. Bless your heart.
I should stop. Yeah, I'll stop. Yeah, you got 2 weeks off. Yeah. If you get fleshly, I'll kill you on those 2 weeks off. If you get so fleshly, you come in here and you do catatonic. What's that? Some people get attacked because of emotional weakness. Now, when you see some people talking, you think they're talking about you. Emotional weakness. Christian people, just because you are born again doesn't mean your soul is born anew. Same Steve, same wicked stepfather that beat him silly, same ruptures, same fracturing, but a born again spirit. And God says, I'm coming in. I'm going to fix you. But it's going to take time. Because we're all a mess. I should have had all of you on that one. I said, we're all a mess. You don't think you're a mess, cowboy. You are not getting in this and through this without shrapnel. And if you cannot confess, as your Bible declares, the only thing good in me is him. If you have any value, please listen, outside of him, you are gravitating towards a religious spirit. There is no value, Paul says, in and of myself. There is no good thing. I am capable of whoredoms. So are you. Wait for an amen. Capable of murder. Did you see on the news that young man that killed his mother? Did you know that he was called into ministry the previous Sunday in a man's church that I know and stabbed his mother to death without yielding to him, to the new nature and to Christ? We're all capable. We are all capable. Why does that hurt someone? Once you understand that, there's a freedom to say, I am deceptively wicked, Isaiah says. Without you, I would be in big trouble. Yeah. Hiding behind good moral works, they're filthy rags. He called them a menstrual rag. Go ahead and present that to God. Without Christ, you and I are evil. You glad you came? Yeah. I'm giving you Bible, front loaded barrel, shotgun, shoot it and let her rip. Yeah. Emotional weakness. That's why you and I need some inner healing. Yeah. He was bruised for our what? Where are bruises? Inside or outside? Inside, inner healing. Spiritual weaknesses, if you're counting, that's the third area of weakness. Men and women that don't know their Bible very well. Men and women that haven't learned to cultivate a life of prayer. And so there's a weakness, and the enemy takes advantage of the weakness.
It's a weak spirit. You're not bad. It's just weak. That's why you should come every Sunday. Because if you can't feed yourself yet, I am here to feed you. That's why he set pastors in the church to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Oh, I'm preaching better than you're saying amen and you're clapping. But it's all right. I'm not dragging this out, am I? That last one, physical weakness. Not taking care of one's body. Now, like I said, I'm not a champion in that. I'm doing the best I can. But just to let you know that the enemy, when you don't feel good, it's hard to be spiritually good. I don't feel good. I don't feel like worship. I've got a stomach ache. He says, hey, try to take care of your body. Do the best you can. Now, we realize it's not first, but try to take care of yourself. We mentioned you should know your numbers. We have people back there taking sugar counts, taking blood counts, blood pressure to make sure you know your numbers, because I'm tired of burying people.
Okay. They opened their treasures. They gave him gold, which was God's character, frankincense. Learned to pray and worship him, and then they gave him myrrh, which was an embalming spice, declaring he's in his birth, he's going to die. They already knew that. He's going to die for the sins of mankind for me. And so they brought an expensive embalming spice, myrrh, and they said this is going to be the end result for him. And they embalmed him, and it is a life of sacrifice. And beloved, it is the call to you and I. It is a life of sacrifice. If you're married, shout amen at me.
Amen.
A good shepherd and shepherdess lays down their life for their sheep. It's not 50-50, it's 100-100. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Single people, you think it's going to be all such a much? Single people shouted me.
Amen.
Oh, you don't want to say anything. It's going to be laying your life down. I'm not talking about abuse. I'm talking about an understanding of this is what he calls you and I to him and to one another. Okay. Why don't you stand to your feet? Bless your heart. Prayer team, are you still here? If you'd come up. Hey, have you heard that Easter or that Christmas message before?
No.
Haha, got you. I think I have in my library probably 30 Christmas messages, and it's like, I'm not using an old one. I want something new, and I will risk failure. I'm going to say this, and you tell me if it's yay or amen. You just say amen. Despise not small beginnings.
Amen.
Remember that Bethlehem is a house of bread and what? Oh, you didn't remember that. House of war. You have family coming. Realize that they're going to. Christ said they're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me. What is the leaven of Herod? Ah, I didn't do very good on that point. He wants to remain as king. Remember? He was going to kill whomever was going to become king. The leaven of Herod does not want to relinquish rulership and the throne in one's life. He said, beware of that leaven. People that don't want to relinquish their life to me. That spirit comes against the Christian in the Christian community. Don't say Merry Christmas, because now rulership comes out. The leaven of Herod becomes angry. No, Merry Christmas. I said Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
What is the leaven of Herod? One more time.
Rulership.
Rulership. Christ is the ruler. Amen. Okay, I think you got the rest of those. Why the Pharisees and Sadducees didn't come to worship him? Because they were religious. The population was, I guess, too busy. And never allow the star to become something that it's not. Father, thank you so much for today. And as we go our separate ways, that we have one thing in common, and is the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And we would ask, oh God, that you would cover every single one, their families, that this would be a time of movement, a time of influence, a time where small things begin to grow. I thank you for them. In the name of Jesus Christ, someone who loves him, shout amen. God bless you. I will see you in about 7 months, however long that is.